Welcome back to another edition of the Prepper Recon Podcast. Our mission is to bring you great interviews with preppers from around the world so you can be better informed and better prepared for everything from a hurricane to the end of the world as we know it. I've been purchasing gold and silver from JM Bullion since before they were a show sponsor because they had the lowest overspot price of any dealer I've been able to find. JM Bullion now offers free shipping on all orders, and Prepper Recon podcast listeners will get $5 off any order over $300. Just go to jmbullion.com and use coupon code PR5 at checkout. Today's guest is Doug Casey. Doug is the founder of Casey Research and the author of several books, including Crisis Investing. Doug, thanks for coming on the show.
My pleasure, Mark. Thank you.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's an honor to have you on. So tell us a little bit about your new book, Right on the Money.
Well, I think the timing is right for a financial book of this nature. The way I describe it is that we entered the leading edge of a gigantic financial hurricane in 2007, and we experienced that in 2008 and 2009, and then for the last several years, we've been in the eye of the hurricane, and it's a bigger storm than I thought because the eye of the hurricane is bigger than you might have imagined. But I think before this year is over, we're going to start going into the trailing edge of the hurricane, and it's going to be much worse and last much longer and be much different than what we had in 2008 and 2009, which, as you'll recall, were scary times.
Yeah, that was pretty scary. Now, one of the things that I first noticed that was different about your book was that there were several links to interviews and charts that were relevant to each chapter that I could access by going to the book's website, which is rightonthemoneybook.com. I followed that M2 money supply link, and it showed the money supply has just about doubled in the past 10 years. What does that do to the purchasing power of the dollar?
Well, it's going to destroy it, of course. It's amazing that the U.S. in particular, but all of the OECD countries are controlled by what you might call a highly intelligent lunatics. They think that quantitative easing, which is just another word for inflation, and it's amazing to me that they can coin a word for a currency debasement or inflation, and everybody starts using it. This is one reason why the good guys, or at least people I think are the good guys, are losing the battle. It's because they allow the enemy to capture the use of the language in these things. Well, in any event, that's a tangent. What I'm trying to say is that if you believe that cause has effect, then you have to believe that doubling the money supply is going to double prices, because the amount of money, prices fluctuate with the amount of money versus the amount of things. So, and it's amazing how they have most people believing that things are actually going to get better because of that. Because what they're saying is we want prices to be higher. But that's insane. If you want a higher standard of living, you actually want prices to be lower. But in any event, this is going to end very badly.
And now the Fed recently announced that they'd cut another $10 billion per month out of their current quantitative easing program. Now, what about the trillions of new dollars that have already been created through the various QE programs? Has the damage already been done by those dollars, or is there still a potential for them to create more wealth destruction through the fractional reserve banking system?
Well, actually, the damage has been done, because once these dollars have been created by the purchase of securities in the open market by the Federal Reserve, they can't easily be uncreated. The problem is that these dollars were basically used to bail out large financial institutions. in the U.S. and Europe. And in my opinion, these things should have been allowed to fail, to go bankrupt. The people that owned them, the people that lent money to them, would be out of luck. But the way they're doing it now is by debasing the currency, the middle class. If you're a member of the middle class, the way you got there is by producing more than you consume and saving the difference. The problem is that people put their savings in dollars, and the dollars are going to be destroyed. And when this happens, the middle class is going to be destroyed. So it's actually quite criminal.
I think what you're talking about, I think we're seeing that right now. President Obama just recently raised the federal contractor's minimum wage to $10.10, and he's calling for a similar hike in the minimum wage across the board. Now, minimum wage has more than doubled since I joined the workforce, but it seems like it's never enough. So I suspect that the problem is not the wage, and it's more the value of the currency that I'm being paid in. Is that correct?
That's quite correct. In any event, if raising the minimum wage did any good, then he really ought to raise it to $20 or perhaps $50 or even $100 an hour. Then everybody that's working would become quite wealthy.
Now, does this increase in the supply of U.S. dollars have anything to do with the instability that we're seeing in the global currency market? The Argentinian peso, Turkish lira, South African rand have all taken major hits in recent weeks.
Yes, and this is a very big factor that most people don't think about. They don't consider it. The standard of living of the average middle-class American has been in a slow, subtle decline for the last couple of generations in real terms. One of the reasons why it hasn't been much steeper than it has been is because the U.S. has been exporting dollars. We don't really know how many U.S. dollars are outside of the U.S., but perhaps about $8 trillion. So we export dollars, and those nice foreigners send us Mercedes and Sonys and other things like that that increase the amount of real wealth in the country, and the amount of paper decreases. The problem is that, referencing your question, is that foreigners don't have to hold those dollars. Americans do, because it's the law that you have to trade in dollars in the U.S. if you buy or sell anything. But at some point, the foreigners are going to lose confidence in the dollar. And unfortunately, the dollar doesn't rest on anything more than confidence. And confidence can blow away like a pile of feathers in a hurricane. So at some point, there's going to be a panic towards the exits, and they're going to start dumping those dollars, and those dollars will have to come back to the U.S. And what will happen? They'll be traded for Boeings and IBMs and stock certificates, ownership of corporations, ownership of land. So the standard of living of Americans will collapse even further. And of course, as those dollars come back to the U.S., that's when inflation will take off in earnest. And I don't see any way out at this point.
And Turkey had to double their interest rate to keep the currency out of free fall, and I suppose to also try to arrest hyperinflation. Could we see that sort of thing happen in America?
Well, interest rates are being artificially suppressed by the Federal Reserve. They can do this by buying bonds, because the price of bonds fluctuates inversely with interest rates. So yes, it's possible for them to suppress the price of interest rates, and that's what they've been doing, because the country is so indebted at this point. Higher interest rates might cause a credit collapse. I mean, if you can handle a big debt at low interest rates, you may not be able to handle it at high interest rates. So as heavily indebted as all sectors of the economy are, of course they're trying to keep interest rates low. I live most of the time, Mark, I actually live in Argentina and Uruguay, which is where I am at the moment. And it's very interesting watching these countries debase their currencies. And of course, nobody cares if the Argentines destroy their peso, because the Argentine peso is just an afterthought. It's meaningless to anybody outside of Argentina. But it's not that way with the dollar, because the dollar is the de facto currency of the world. It's the major asset of most foreign central banks. It's used in day-to-day life as a currency in about 50 countries around the world, and it's the de jure currency in at least three or four: Ecuador, Panama, Liberia, and one other. Well, actually, Zimbabwe is using the dollar now. So, no, it's very serious.
If you were a doctor and the U.S. economic system was your patient, how long would you say that patient has left to live? Does he have months, years, or decades?
Good question. I'm a long-term student of ancient history. It interests me. And it took the Roman Empire a long time to decline and fall. So it's hard to predict these things. And as Adam Smith said, there's a lot of ruin in a nation. So who knows? Maybe they can wring one more cycle out of this by printing up more money or putting on more regulations. It's hard to say. But one thing I am confident about is that as we go into the trailing edge of this hurricane that we're in, it is going to be much uglier and much longer lasting and much different than it was in 2008 and 2009. One thing that I expect to be different is this time we will have rapid retail price increases. So that's going to be different. When will we actually go over the edge? This is hard to say. I mean, I'm shocked that the Soviet Union lasted as long as it did, from roughly 1918 to 1989. I wouldn't have expected that. So who knows how long this can drag on.
And what should Joe Main Street be doing right now to prepare for that day? Is gold a good form of wealth protection?
Well, yes, it is. But what's important when you buy gold, as when you buy anything, is the price you pay for it. Now, just a little bit of historical background that I think it's important that people keep this in mind. Gold in my lifetime was a gigantic bargain twice before. Once as a speculation, and I've got to define speculation as an allocation of capital to take advantage of politically caused distortions in the marketplace. One that was 1971, when it was $35 an ounce. And from that point, of course, it exploded. And by the time a decade had gone by, it was over 800. And then it was in nowhere land for 20 years. And then in 2001, it got as low as 260, and then ran to 1900 a couple of years ago. And now it's descended again to about 1250 or 1275. Now, as we speak, I'd say that gold at 1250 is actually as good a value as it was in 1971 and 2001. In real terms, it's not as cheap. But the world's political and economic and social and military situations are much more serious than they were in those previous years. So even though in real terms gold isn't the bargain that it was then, I think it's more important to own it now than it was then even.
And last year, Germany announced that they would be repatriating 300 tons of gold from the New York Fed over the next 7 years. They only received 5 tons last year. Does this remind you of Charles de Gaulle when he wanted to recall Francis Gold in the late 60s, which caused Nixon to eventually default on the Bretton Woods system, and brings us to the period that you just mentioned in 1971 when gold was $35.
Yes, it is similar. Although I've got to say, I don't like to refer to gold in terms of tons. I don't know where this meme originated, because gold isn't bought or sold in terms of tons. It's not priced in tons. People don't use it in tons. People don't even know what a ton of gold looks like. Historically, gold has always been spoken of in terms of ounces. And I wonder if they started using tons to seem more, to make it seem irrelevant. Because a ton of gold is something that nobody could really hope to own unless they're a billionaire. Anyway, yes, that is disturbing. That's a tangent. I'm sorry. But the fact that the Germans asked for their gold and haven't gotten delivery of it, I'd be pretty scared if I were the Germans that owned that gold. Why can't they get the gold? That's a very good question.
And do you have any expectations for the gold price over the next year, or do you just buy it as an insurance policy?
Well, look, the most important reason to own gold is not as a speculation. You want to own it because it's the only financial asset that's not simultaneously somebody else's liability. Well, that's also true of silver, but silver is primarily an industrial metal and only secondarily a monetary metal, at least in today's world. Give me the question again. I once more went off on a tangent.
That's fine. And do you have an expectation for the price of gold over the next year?
Ah, of course. Look, as I said, I buy gold consistently. I try to buy it every month, whether it goes high or goes low, because it's a financial asset that's not somebody else's liability. And in today's world, when most of these financial institutions are bankrupt, including the U.S. government, you want something like that. So the answer to the question is, yes, it's going higher, and I think considerably higher over the next few years. I think that the downturn in gold over the last couple of years is finished, and the next step is up. So once again, it's not just a prudent holding, but it's, again, a sound speculation in addition to being a prudent holding.
And then when gold starts to see when or if gold starts to see astronomical price levels, do you expect that people will then start to shift over to silver as a monetary metal for wealth protection when gold becomes out of reach for the average man?
Well, you know, I like silver as a speculation, but it takes so much of it to have significant wealth that it's inconvenient. You'll recall that there are five characteristics of a good money. It's got to be durable, divisible, convenient, consistent, and have value of itself. And that one, convenient, that's why we don't use lead as money. That's why we don't use copper as money, really. It takes too much of it to be of value. That's why we use gold as money. And we don't use silver as money too much. Well, relative to other things, if silver goes to $100 or $200 an ounce, then it's a different story. But no, I'm favorably inclined towards silver. It's a high-tech metal. It's the most reflective of all metals. It's the most conductive of both electricity and heat. So and it's got other characteristics that make it more and more useful in today's world all the time. I'm definitely a bull on silver.
And what percentage of your total assets do you think gold or gold and silver should make up?
I'd say at this particular point, a substantial portion. Warren Buffett, who's a bit of an idiot savant. I mean, he's a genius at investing. one of the best investors in history. He's proved that if you really want to make money with your money, the way you do it is by putting it into good businesses that are going to grow. I mean, that really is the way to become wealthy, through investing. You can't hope to become wealthy through investing. And, well, you can't invest in gold and silver themselves, because technically speaking, investing is putting capital into something that will grow by production. So gold and silver are something that you hold on to conserve wealth at any time and to speculate in other times. So I'd like to be able to say buy solid common growth stocks, which is what's made Buffett a multi-billionaire. But there's a time for everything. And right now, the stock market is very overpriced, in my opinion, by almost any standard. So I'm not interested in stocks at the moment. I'd like to be interested in them, perhaps when you can get 6 or 8% in current dividends on the Dow Jones, and then they'd be very cheap. And at that point, I'd be tempted to sell a lot of gold and silver and move into common stocks, but not now.
And how bad do you expect things to get when our day of reckoning arrives? Will it be something like the Great Depression, something far worse, or not quite as bad?
Well, I've said for a long time that I expect it's going to be so bad that it's going to be worse than even I think it's going to be. And I say that in a cautionary way, actually, because when I look at the long term, actually, the future is likely to be not only better than we imagine, but perhaps even better than we can imagine. It's a question of sorting out the short term, which is likely to be nasty, from the long term. Now, why am I bullish on the long term? Because I hate to come across as a gloom and doomer. You have to look at why things over the long term will get better. And there are two reasons for that. Number one is there are more scientists and engineers alive today than have lived in all of previous history put together. And they're going to continue discovering things, inventing things, developing things. And that's the mainspring of human progress. That's why the standard of living will go up over the long term. The second reason is that every individual who's a member of the middle class anyway, that's not slopping at the government's trough, understands that he has to produce more than he consumes and save the difference. That's how capital is created. And that's the second reason why things will get better over the long term. But we're not talking about the long term right now. We're talking about the next decade. And I think it's going to be really tumultuous. It's not just an economic and financial crash we're looking at, because when things get bad, these governments look for somebody to blame. And as Rudolf Steiner famously said, war is the health of the state. So bad times usually lead to wars, and that's not something to look forward to.
And for the short term, do you think that people should be concerned about living in a densely populated area when things start to fall apart?
Well, I love cities. They're convenient. They're centers of culture. But in times like this, I think you'd do better to be out of the city. I'm speaking to you now from a very pleasant beach town in Uruguay, a little country with only 4 million people, and most of it's just empty. So I'd say a place like this is going to be much better to be than downtown Chicago. That's why I'm here.
And what are your thoughts on farmland as an investment or as a means of providing for ourselves if things really fall apart to the point that maybe there's disruptions in the supply chain?
Well, my friend Jim Rogers has said that in the last generation, if you were smart, you had been an investment banker, and everybody looked at a farmer as being a rube, a hayseed, kind of an idiot. But in generations to come, the shoe is going to be on the other foot. And I think he's quite correct on that. There are some caveats to that, though. It's that most of the farmers, the big crops in the world are wheat and corn, soybeans and rice. These are mass crops. They're industrially produced. They're monocultures. And I wonder what the risks are with that being the case. But still, that said, yeah, I like the idea of being on a farm. And here in Argentina, I have a farm, a rather big, nice farm, and we grow cattle, which I think are very cheap now. I think cattle are probably the cheapest part of the agro-complex as we speak.
And you talk in your book about the tightening noose. Do you think the U.S. government would likely take advantage of an economic crisis to grab more power and trample more freedoms?
Well, I think the kind of people that are attracted to government, that go into government, are the type of people that they're not interested in controlling physical reality. They're interested in controlling other people. So government tends to draw a pathological type of personality, actually a criminal type of personality. I mean, Hitler and Stalin and Mao and people of that nature, and we have American lookalikes for them. They didn't go into a business. They went into politics. So yes, of course, that's what these people are interested in. And they take advantage of crises. Like, who's that horrible person that's the mayor of Chicago right now? Rahm Emanuel. As he said, can't let a good crisis go to waste. So sure, it's going to get worse. Trends in motion tend to stay in motion until some crisis either stops them or perhaps changes them or accelerates them. But we haven't even reached the crisis yet. And you can see what's happened in the U.S. and indeed all of the developed countries in the last couple of generations. Every year, more laws, more controls, higher taxes. And that's going to accelerate because the state is interested in taking care of itself first and foremost. And you're a means to its ends. Right now, we're being treated as milk cows by the government. But if they think it's necessary, they'll treat us like beef cows.
And do you think the founders of America would be proud of the way we've adhered to the Constitution and our founding principles? And what do you think that if Thomas Jefferson could come back right now, what would he say to the American people?
Well, I would think that he would just read from his own book and think that the time had come for another revolution. But I'm not sure. Well, of course, only about a third of Americans, even in his time, actually supported the American Revolution. And I'd say that if that type of thing happened today, it would be much less than a third, because you've got to remember over half of Americans today are receiving benefits from the government, more benefits than they pay in taxes. Not that I think anybody should have to pay taxes. But if Jefferson came back today, I think he'd have a hard time rounding up the equivalent of the Sons of Liberty in those days. Things have changed. Americans have become soft and corrupt.
So what can we do to position ourselves to rebuild on the other side of the coming collapse?
Well, financially speaking, I look at all the markets all around the world. In fact, I just wrote a report on the Cyprus stock markets, very small market with only about 110 stocks. You can only invest in about 20 of them effectively. And it's down 98% from its peak. So I look at things like that. But With the exception of anomalies like that, almost nothing in the financial world is cheap today. We're in the middle of a gigantic bond bubble, which is bigger than the real estate bubble of a few years ago and bigger than the stock bubble that broke in 2001. There's almost nothing that's cheap except for gold and silver. And as a speculation, gold mining stocks are a fantastic bargain right now. They could be explosive, giving 10-to-1 returns in the next couple of years on the upside. But so you've got to do something like that financially. I really think it's important for Americans to diversify their assets internationally, because if all your assets are in the U.S., you're adopting the attitude of a medieval serf, where you're restricting yourself just to the place that you were born. I think it's important to be mobile. I mean, in a crisis situation, acting like a plant is not a good survival strategy. So you have to be willing and able to get up and leave if the going gets tough. So that's what I would suggest from a financial and from a personal lifestyle point of view. At least that's what I'm doing.
And you mentioned that you think that the bonds are in a bubble. Would you think that inverse bond ETFs would be a good play?
I think it is a good play, although it seemed like a good play for the last 4 years. And interest rates have been left at these very low levels for 4 years. So they've been a very bad deal, even though they should have been a good deal for the last 4 years. If you want to play that, I think, there are more sophisticated and certain ways to do it. For instance, I would go long Japanese stocks versus short Japanese bonds, because the yen is even a worse currency than the U.S., and Japanese interest rates are even more suppressed and more deserving of going up than American interest rates. And by going simultaneously long Japanese stocks, you're covering a lot of risk. And as they create more yen, they're going to drive more money into the stock market. So there's a lot of ways to play this. What you mentioned is one of them, but perhaps this will go on for another year or two. I don't think so. I think we're on the edge of the precipice now, but it seemed that way for the last couple of years.
Well, Doug, you've given us an awful lot of great information to think about and some good stuff to go back and research later. And, of course, we're going to have a link to purchase your book, Right on the Money, through Amazon in today's show notes. And we'll also have a link to Casey Research. But for the folks that are listening to us on Stitcher, YouTube, iTunes, can you tell them where they can find you?
Me personally? Well,
or just for Casey Research.
Most of the year I'm in South America, although I travel a lot. The book's available on Amazon too, of course.
And then it also has its own website as well, is that correct?
So right on the moneybook.com, if I'm not mistaken.
And then Casey Research is caseyresearch.com?
We have a lot of free publications there that I think people should take a look at. They have a lot of good information, so I do recommend that they take advantage of that free resource.
Well, we sure do appreciate you taking the time out of your day to come on the show today.
Thanks, Mark, and it's very nice having talked to you.
Hey, preppers and patriots. American Meltdown, the long-awaited sequel to American Exit Strategy, is now available in Kindle and paperback. In American Meltdown, Book 2 of the Economic Collapse Chronicles, the new president, Anthony Howe, signs an executive order banning all semi-automatic weapons. Matt, Adam, and Wesley Bear begin training with their local militia for the battle that is coming. Within weeks of the inauguration, the $700 trillion derivatives bubble pops when rates on U.S. debt skyrocket. The derivatives crisis is the final nail in the coffin of the banking system and the death of the fiat currency system in America. With the dollar gone, commerce comes to a screeching halt. While times prove to be tough for all, survival favors the prepared. Get your Kindle or paperback copy of American Meltdown Book 2 of the Economic Collapse Chronicles on Amazon today. This episode is brought to you by CampingSurvival.com. Whether your plan is to bug out or bug in, CampingSurvival.com has all of your preparedness needs, including bug-out bags, long-term storage food, water filters, gas mask, and first aid kits. Check them out online today at CampingSurvival.com. Be sure to enter coupon code PREPPERRECON for a 5% discount on your entire order.